By the late 1800s, pugilism, fisticuffs, prize fighting was a popular sporting activity, and by whatever name used, boxing was all the rage. A civilized sport, all matches followed an accepted set of rules, and some fights were known to last over 6 hours, leaving the competitors exhausted and bloodied. In 1877, the middleweight champion Mike Donovan, also known as Professor Mike Donovan, was preparing for an upcoming fight in Troy, New York, where he had been teaching at the Polytechnic Institute. Speaking to a friend one evening, he noticed a round football and had an idea that would ultimately affect thousands of athletes and become a standard in boxing training to this day. Heading home with ball in hand, he gathered a common ice screw, some strong cord, and a flour sack.
Arriving at my room, I fastened the screw into the ceiling. I then fastened my rope to the screw and, putting my ball into the sack, I fastened it closely to the ball by making several loops on the mouth of the sack.
After punching the ball several times, he decided to bring it up to his chin height and found it to be a much more effective form of training. Further improvements led to creating a tighter canvas cover with laces and a loop sewn in for easier attachment to the cord.
I did not then realize that I was inventing a popular apparatus that was to do so much good to boxers, athletes, and to those who have received the benefits from its use.
Returning to New York City, he established a training facility and decided to suspend a wooden disc or platform from the ceiling, which created a 2-foot swing of the punching ball. This gave him a much more reactive workout. More thoughts of developing the punching ball would lead to creating a light leather cover for an even quicker rebound.
I might state here that while I was training in California, I astonished all the professionals and amateurs who witnessed my exhibition on the ball. They were loud in their praise and said that they had never seen anything like it before.
While training on his punching ball, Donovan was visited by a sporting goods man wanting to sell him a pulling apparatus. After losing the sale, the salesman inquired about the punching ball. Realizing the benefits, both physical and financial, the punching ball was soon on the market and available to the general public.
Not thinking there was anything in it financially, I let it drift until 1886, when after consulting a lawyer, he informed me that I had let it go too long to claim any royalty. But I can say, and defy contradiction, that I am the inventor of the rubber punching ball.
Since its creation in the late 1800s, the punching ball had seen a boom of popularity. People were amazed by Professor Mike Donovan's punching demonstrations, and as the bag became available to the general public, the physical benefits as a form of exercise became apparent. In 1895, publications featuring the health benefits of bag punching started to appear. Jules Frank's Bag Punching was one of the first. Punching the bag had reached such popularity that it had become a recognized fad among professional boxers and people looking for a cost-effective apparatus for home training. By the early 1900s, you could find many exercise manuals explaining the benefits of a healthy life. Both men and women found it to be a great addition to the many pulling machines and known workouts of the day. Bell Gordon, William Duncan, Young Corbett, and Gus Keller all authored booklets that demonstrated punching ball techniques. The punching ball was not limited to just hanging from a ceiling or platform, but was also mounted vertically on a wall or on the floor for use with the feet. No limb was off limits, and fancy punching was the term of the day. These punchers often used hands, elbows, feet, knees, and even their heads. Multiple bags on large platforms were often used in synchronization. The puncher had bags going with both hands, both feet or knees, and even threw in a few head hits for good measure. Gus Keller can be seen here showing off some of his techniques on the bag. Known as a fancy puncher, Gus had many tricks up his sleeve and was a true artist when it came to punching the bag.
Thank you.
With the punching bag's popularity growing, vaudeville acts popped up throughout the circuit, entertaining the crowds with their punching prowess. But by the 1930s, vaudeville was being replaced by a new medium of entertainment, motion pictures. People were more interested in seeing this new technology, and although there's nothing like seeing the speed bag punched in person, the thrill was gone. In the following years, fancy punching seemed to take a back seat to the known benefits of straight boxer-style punching. Improved punching speed, eye-hand coordination, and increased stamina have helped many boxers move up the ranks. It wasn't until the early 1970s that Charles Roy Schroeder started to bring it all back in his book, Boxing Skills. Little did he know that one of his students would take his teachings to the next level and ultimately create what is now known as Bible-style punching.